Hi, in our today's video, it is more tonight's video, as it is 20 past 9 p.m. now, in this moment, as I shoot this video. But never mind. The important thing, what we're going to be talking about, is the ECU. You know this one, this guy. Well, and as you could see from the title, let's answer the question, does the ECU fail? yes. It fails. The answer is yes, but only under that condition if you left your ignition on and you then want, just like this, to take out its plug, then this part, well, maybe doesn't fail, but it is going to be damaged for sure. That's the only case when your ECU is going to fail. So, in this video, the point is that you should never. That would be the last thing, let's say it like that. You should never replace these. They don't fail. How come? Let me prove it to you. They don't fail. They simply don't. What happens is that the sensors go bad. They fail. And how the ECU is going to be working, that depends on its sensors. Primarily, if something goes bad and if your car starts working in a safe mode, let's say it like that, then this is the culprit. This thing called the OVP, because then maybe it's a thing, this one, if you see, this thing is called the Zener diode. If this diode fails, then positive and ground connect, and then it's most likely that your fuse is going to blow. Then it happens what happens, because the current generated in the car is more than 12 volts and the ECU works on 12 volts. And then, in order for the ECU not to blow, to burn, this is what prevents ECU from any hazards, from any failures. This, with its fuses that bend or they simply burn on health, and then there is no current, there is no voltage supply. That is important. Why am I telling you all this stuff? Because there are still people that believe that their ECUs are bad. No, the ECU, I'm going to repeat this again. The ECU works only the way the input signal sensors tell him to do. So the quality of its work depends on the sensors. It's going to be rather that the sensors are bad and not the ECU. And now, as we were talking about the OVP, let me tell you what happens. As the OVP goes bad, then the ECU loses here the voltage supply on the contact number 1. It's contact number 20, this one here is the ground, but it's for nothing. The ground is then for nothing if we don't have the positive, the voltage supply. And that supply must go from the battery through this thing. Let's see on one very simple example. Let's take the battery as an example of the power supply, and let's see what happens when the positive is unplugged from the battery. As soon as I open the door, the bulb will have to turn on if we have power in the car. Does it turn on? It doesn't. And now, let's see what happens as I plug both the positive and the ground. Do we have power now? Yes, we do. And now, what happens now if something fails? If the OVP fails, then you have no voltage supply, as I've already told you. As you have no voltage supply, then your lambda is dead, then your potentiometer is dead, your microswitch cut off is dead, your speed sensor is dead, your AC compressor is dead, TPS. Well, it maybe sends signal to the ignition module, ECL. The same thing goes for the CTS. And now those that have to get the current, those milliamps we need, they are dead as well. That goes for the EHA, and that goes as well as for the idle control valve. Because the ICV gets its voltage, its positive from the OVP, and the negative it gets from the ECU. So now we have neither the OVP nor the ECU working. So your ICV is dead. It goes in safe mode. The car is going to be be working, of course, because we have the EZL, and the EZL creates the TD signal, which then goes from the ignition module to the X11 port, yes, and from there it goes to the X11/4. And then, of course, to the fuel pump relay, etc. Here, this is the proof that KE can work without the ECU. Because the only one of all the sensors we have now, which are needed for the ECU to work properly, is the ignition module and nothing else. You want to see how the ECU looks like inside? Here, now I'm going to show you that. Here, now I want to show you how the ECU looks from inside. In order to come to the board, we need to loosen four of these. One here, one here, one here, and one here. This is Torx T8. You must have that one in order to come to the ECU, to the board. Let me unscrew it. Da 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 da. Here, this is how the ECU looks from inside. Here, there. If someone from you understands how this works, well, then okay. For me, this is rocket science, to be honest with you. Here, look. I think I can find something where is what located and what is what, but I'm not so sure if I can find this, but here. This is from the car, which is manufactured in 1990, as well as I know. And this is how it looks like. There. Look at the Germans. What? They are so precise, and everything is told for you. Here, it says Rückseite. They tell you everything where you have to solder. So that's it. Maybe I can find something, some literature about what is what, but as far as my logic tells me, everything you can do here is just to change either this one, this one, this one, these capacitors. Well, I don't know, but here, this is how the ECU looks like from inside. So, my message to all of you that want to replace the ECU, don't do that. Don't throw your money on the ECU. Okay, I know that this unit does not cost a fortune, or I don't know how much, but be sure nothing, and I repeat, nothing is going to change if you replace this one or not. So my dear ones, if you enjoyed this video, then please don't click the button skip ad. It is going to help me a lot. And till the next video, happy Mercedesing. Bye.